A Waif on the Plains. By Bret Harte. Podcast 3 of 5. Chapter 6. Then followed days and weeks that seemed to Clarence as a dream. At first, an interval of hushed and awed restraint when he and Susie were kept apart, a strange and artificial interest taken little note of by him, but afterwards remembered when others had forgotten it, the burial of Mrs. Silsby beneath a cairn of stones, with some ceremonies that, simple though they were, seemed to usurp the sacred rites of grief from him and Susie, and leave them cold and frightened, days of frequent and incoherent childish outbursts from Susie, growing fainter and rarer as time went on, until they ceased, he knew not when, the haunting by night of that morning vision of the three or four heaps of ragged clothes on the ground and a half-regret that he had not examined them more closely, a recollection of the awful loneliness and desolation of the broken and abandoned wagon left behind on its knees as if praying mutely when the train went on and left it, the trundling behind of the fateful wagon in which Mrs. Silsby's body had been found, superstitiously shunned by everyone. And when at last turned over to the authorities at an outpost garrison, seeming to drop the last link from the dragging chain of the past. The revelation to the children of a new experience in that brief glimpse of the frontier garrison, the handsome officer in uniform and belted sword, an heroic, vengeful figure to be admired and imitated hereafter, the sudden importance and respect given to Susie and himself as survivors, the sympathetic questioning and kindly exaggerations of their experiences, quickly accepted by Susie, all these, looking back upon them afterwards, seemed to have passed in a dream. No less strange and visionary to them seemed the real transitions they noted from the moving train. How one morning they missed the changeless, motionless, low, dark line along the horizon, and before noon found themselves among the rocks and trees and a swiftly rushing river. How there suddenly appeared beside them a few days later a great gray cloud-covered ridge of mountains that they were convinced was that same dark line that they had seen so often. How the men laughed at them, and said that for the last 3 days they had been crossing that dark line, and that it was higher than the great gray clouded range before them, which it had always hidden from their view. How Susie firmly believed that these changes took place in her sleep, when she always kinder felt they were crawling up, and how Clarence, in the happy depreciation of extreme youth, expressed his conviction that they weren't a bit high, after all. How the weather became cold, though it was already summer, and at night the campfire was a necessity, and there was a stove in the tent with Susie, and yet how all this faded away, and they were again upon a dazzling, burnt, and sun-dried plain. But always as in a dream. More real were the persons who composed the party whom they seemed to have always known and who, in the innocent caprice of children, had become to them more actual than the dead had even been. There was Mr. Peyton, who they now knew owned the train, and who was so rich that he needn't go to California if he didn't want to, and was going to buy a great deal of it if he liked it, and who was also a lawyer and policeman, which was Susie's rendering of politician, and was called squire and judge at the frontier outpost, and could order anybody to be took up if he wanted to, and who knew everybody by their Christian names, and Mrs. Peyton, who had been delicate and was ordered by the doctor to live in the open air for 6 months, and never go into a house or a town agent, and who was going to adopt Susie as soon as her husband could arrange with Susie's relatives, and draw up the papers. How Harry was Henry Benham, Mrs. Peyton's brother, and a kind of partner of Mr. Peyton. And how the scout's name was Gus Gildersleeve, or the White Crow, and how, through his recognized intrepidity, an attack upon their train was no doubt averted. Then there was Bill, the stock herder, and Texas Jim, the vaquero, the latter marvelous and unprecedented in horsemanship. Such were their companions, as appeared through the gossip of the train and their own inexperienced consciousness. To them, they were all astounding and important personages. But, either from boyish curiosity or some sense of being misunderstood, Clarence was more attracted by the two individuals of the party who were least kind to him, namely, Mrs. Peyton and her brother Harry. I fear that, after the fashion of most children, and some grown-up people, he thought less of the steady kindness of Mr. Peyton and the others than of the rare tolerance of Harry or the polite concessions of his sister. Miserably conscious of this at times, he quite convinced himself that if he could only win a word of approbation from Harry, or a smile from Mrs. Peyton, he would afterwards revenge himself by running away. Whether he would or not, I cannot say. I am writing of a foolish, growing, impressionable boy of 11, of whose sentiments nothing could be safely predicted but uncertainty. It was at this time that he became fascinated by another member of the party whose position had been too humble and unimportant to be included in the group already noted. Of the same appearance as the other teamsters in size, habits, and apparel, he had not at first exhibited to Clarence any claim to sympathy. But it appeared that he was actually a youth of only 16, a hopeless incorrigible of St. Joseph, whose parents had prevailed on Peyton to allow him to join the party, by way of removing him from evil associations and as a method of reform. Of this Clarence was at first ignorant, not from any want of frankness on the part of the youth, for that ingenious young gentleman later informed him that he had killed 3 men in St. Louis, 2 in St. Joe, and that the officers of justice were after him. But it was evident that to precocious habits of drinking, smoking, chewing, and card playing this overgrown youth added a strong tendency to exaggeration of statement. Indeed, he was known as Lying Jim Hooker, and his various qualities presented a problem to Clarence that was attractive and inspiring, doubtful, but always fascinating. With the hoarse voice of early wickedness and a contempt for ordinary courtesy, he had a round, perfectly good-humored face, and a disposition that when not called upon to act up to his self-imposed role of reckless wickedness, was not unkindly. It was only a few days after the massacre, and while the children were still wrapped in the gloomy interest and frightened reticence which followed it, that Jim Hooker first characteristically flashed upon Clarence's perceptions. Hanging half on and half off the saddle of an Indian pony, the lank Jim suddenly made his appearance, dashing violently up and down the track, and around the wagon in which Clarence was sitting, tugging desperately at the reins, with every indication of being furiously run away with, and retaining his seat only with the most dauntless courage and skill. Round and round they went, the helpless rider at times hanging by a single stirrup near the ground, and again recovering himself by, as it seemed to Clarence, almost superhuman effort. Clarence sat open-mouthed with anxiety and excitement, and yet a few of the other teamsters laughed. Then the voice of Mr. Peyton, from the window of his car, said quietly, "There, that will do, Jim. Quit it." The furious horse and rider instantly disappeared. A few moments after, the bewildered Clarence saw the redoubted horseman trotting along quietly in the dust of the rear, on the same fiery steed, who in that prosaic light bore an astounding resemblance to an ordinary team horse. Later in the day he sought an explanation from the rider. "You see," answered Jim gloomily, "thar ain't a galoot in this here crowd easy knows just what's in that hoss. And them easy suspects daren't say. It wouldn't do for to heve it let out that the judge hez a Morgan Mexican plug that's killed 2 men afore he got him, and is bound to kill another afore he gets through. Why, Annie, the week afore we came up to you, that thar hoss bolted with me at camping. Bucked and throwed me, but I kept my holt o' the stirrups with my foot so. Dragged me a matter of 2 miles, head down, and me keepin' away rocks with my hand so. Why didn't you loose your foot and let go?" asked Clarence breathlessly. "You might," said Jim, with deep scorn, "that ain't my style. I just laid low till we came to a steep pitched hill, and goin' down when the hoss was, so to speak, kinder below me, I just turned a handspring, so, and that landed me onto his back again." This action, though vividly illustrated by Jim's throwing his hands down like feet beneath him, and indicating the parabola of a spring in the air, proving altogether too much for Clarence's mind to grasp, he timidly turned to a less difficult detail. "What made the horse bolt first, Mr. Hooker?" "Smelt Injuns," said Jim, carelessly expectorating tobacco juice in a curving jet from the side of his mouth, a singularly fascinating accomplishment, peculiarly his own, and likely your Injuns. "But," argued Clarence hesitatingly, "you said it was a week before end. Our Mexican plug can smell Injuns 50, yes, 100 miles away," said Jim, with scornful deliberation, and if Judge Peyton had took my advice, and hadn't been so mighty feared about the character of his hoss gettin' out, he'd HEV played roots on them engines afore they touched yet. But, he added, with gloomy dejection, there ain't no sand in this year crowd, thar ain't no vim, thar ain't nothin', and thar gone TB easy long easy, thar's women and babies, and women and baby fixins, mixed up with it. I'd HEV cut the whole blamed gang if it weren't for one or two things, he added darkly. Clarence, impressed by Jim's mysterious manner, for the moment forgot his contemptuous allusion to Mr. Peyton, and the evident implication of Susie and himself, and asked hurriedly, what things? Jim, as if forgetful of the boy's presence in his fitful mood, abstractedly half drew a glittering Bowie knife from his bootleg, and then slowly put it back again. There's one or two old scores, he continued, in a low voice, although no one was in hearing distance of them, one or two private accounts, he went on tragically, averting his eyes as if watched by someone, that HEV to be wiped out with blood afore I leave. There's one or two men too many alive and breathing in this here crowd. Mebby it's Gus Gildersleeve, mebby it's Harry Benham, mebby, he added, with a dark yet noble disinterestedness, it's me. Oh, no, said Clarence, with polite deprecation. Far from placating the gloomy Jim, this seemed only to awake his suspicions. Mebby, he said, dancing suddenly away from Clarence, mebby you think I'm lying. Mebby you think, because you're Colonel Brandt's son, you can run me with this your train. Mebby, he continued, dancing violently back again, ye calculate, because ye run off and stampeded a baby, ye can tote me round too, sonny. Mebby, he went on, executing a double shuffle in the dust and alternately striking his hands on the sides of his boots, mebby you're spying round and reportin' to the judge. Firmly convinced that Jim was working himself up by an Indian war dance to some desperate assault on himself, but resenting the last unjust accusation, Clarence had recourse to one of his old dogged silences. Happily at this moment an authoritative voice called out, "Now, then, you Jim Hooker," and the desperate Hooker, as usual, vanished instantly. Nevertheless, he appeared an hour or two later beside the wagon in which Susie and Clarence were seated, with an expression of satiated vengeance and remorseful blood guiltiness in his face, and his hair combed Indian fashion over his eyes. As he generously contented himself with only passing a gloomy and disparaging criticism on the game of cards that the children were playing, it struck Clarence for the first time that a great deal of his real wickedness resided in his hair. This set him to thinking that it was strange that Mr. Peyton did not try to reform him with a pair of scissors, but not until Clarence himself had for at least 4 days attempted to imitate Jim by combing his own hair in that fashion. A few days later, Jim again casually favored him with a confidential interview. Clarence had been allowed to best ride one of the team leaders postillion Weiss, and was correspondingly elevated, when Jim joined him, on the Mexican plug, which appeared no doubt a part of its wicked art heavily docile, and even slightly lame. "How much," said Jim, in a tone of gloomy confidence, "how much did you reckon to make by stealing that gal baby, sonny?" "Nothing," replied Clarence with a smile. Perhaps it was an evidence of the marked influence that Jim was beginning to exert over him that he already did not attempt to resent this fascinating implication of grown-up guilt. "It orter been a good job, if it warn't he revenge," continued Jim moodily. "No, it wasn't revenge," said Clarence hurriedly. "Then ye calculated ter get er $100 reward if the old man and old woman hadn't been sulped afore yet got up to em," said Jim. "That's your blamed dodgasted luck, eh? Anyhow, you'll make Mrs. Peyton plank down suthin if she adopts the babby. Look here, young feller," he said, starting suddenly and throwing his face forward, glaring fiendishly through his matted side locks, "do ye mean ter tell me it wasn't a plant a skin game the hull thing?" "Eh what?" said Clarence. "Do ye mean to say it was wonderful how gratuitously husky his voice became at this moment? Do ye mean ter tell me ye didn't set on them engines to wipe out the Silsbys, so that ye could HEV an out-and-out gal orphan on hand for Mrs. Peyton ter adopt et? but here Clarence was forced to protest, and strongly, although Jim contemptuously ignored it. "Don't lie ter me," he repeated mysteriously, "I'm fly. I'm dark, young fell. We're cahoots in this thing." And with this artful suggestion of being in possession of Clarence's guilty secret, he departed in time to elude the usual objurgation of his superior, Phil, the head teamster. Nor was his baleful fascination exercised entirely on Clarence. In spite of Mrs. Peyton's jealously affectionate care, Clarence's frequent companionship, and the little circle of admiring courtiers that always surrounded Susie, it became evident that this small Eve had been secretly approached and tempted by the satanic Jim. She was found one day to have a few heron's feathers in her possession with which she adorned her curls, and at another time was discovered to have rubbed her face and arms with yellow and red ochre, confessedly the free gift of Jim Hooker. It was to Clarence alone that she admitted the significance and purport of these offerings. "Jim give them to me," she said, "and Jim's a kind of Injin hisself that won't hurt me, and when bad Injins come, they'll think I'm his Injin baby and run away. And Jim said if I'd just told the Injins when they came to kill Papa and Mama, that I belonged to him, they'd HEV runned away. But," said the practical Clarence, "you could not, you know you were with Mrs. Peyton all the time." "Clarence," said Susie, shaking her head and fixing her round blue eyes with calm mendacity on the boy, "don't you tell me. I was there." Clarence started back, and nearly fell over the wagon in hopeless dismay at this dreadful revelation of Susie's powers of exaggeration. "But," he gasped, "you know, Susie, you and me left before." "Clarence," said Susie calmly, making a little pleat in the skirt of her dress with her small thumb and fingers, "don't you talk to me. I was there. Ise said Iver. The men at the fort said so. The Sarivair is a loose there, and a loose knows everything." Clarence was too dumbfounded to reply. He had a vague recollection of having noticed before that Susie was very much fascinated by the reputation given to her at Fort Ridge as a survivor, and was trying in an infantile way to live up to it. This the wicked Jim had evidently encouraged. For a day or two Clarence felt a little afraid of her, and more lonely than ever. It was in this state, and while he was doggedly conscious that his association with Jim did not prepossess Mrs. Peyton or her brother in his favor, and that the former even believed him responsible for Susie's unhallowed acquaintance with Jim, that he drifted into one of those youthful escapades on which elders are apt to sit in severe but not always considerate judgment. Believing, like many other children, that nobody cared particularly for him, except to restrain him, discovering, as children do, much sooner than we complacently imagine, that love and preference have no logical connection with desert or character, Clarence became boyishly reckless. But when, one day, it was rumored that a herd of buffalo was in the vicinity, and that the train would be delayed the next morning in order that a hunt might be organized, by Gildersleeve, Benham, and a few others, Clarence listened willingly to Jim's proposition that they should secretly follow it. To effect their unhallowed purpose required boldness and duplicity. It was arranged that shortly after the departure of the hunting party Clarence should ask permission to mount and exercise one of the team horses, a favor that had been frequently granted him, that in the outskirts of the camp he should pretend that the horse ran away with him, and Jim would start in pursuit. The absence of the shooting party with so large a contingent of horses and men would preclude any further detachment from the camp to assist them. Once clear, they would follow the track of the hunters, and, if discovered by them, would offer the same excuse, with the addition that they had lost their way to the camp. The plan was successful. The details were carried out with almost too perfect effect, as it appeared that Jim, in order to give dramatic intensity to the fractiousness of Clarence's horse, had inserted a thorn apple under the neck of his saddle, which Clarence only discovered in time to prevent himself from being unseated. Urged forward by ostentatious woes, and surreptitious cuts in the rear from Jim, pursuer and pursued presently found themselves safely beyond the half-dry stream and fringe of alder bushes that skirted the camp. They were not followed. Whether the teamsters suspected and winked at this design, or believed that the boys could take care of themselves, and ran no risk of being lost in the proximity of the hunting party, there was no general alarm. Thus reassured, and having a general idea of the direction of the hunt, the boys pushed hilariously forward. Before them opened a vast expanse of bottom land, slightly sloping on the right to a distant half-filled lagoon, formed by the main river overflow, on whose tributary they had encamped. The lagoon was partly hidden by straggling timber and brush, and beyond that again stretched the unlimitable plains, the pasture of their mighty game. Hither, Jim hoarsely informed his companion, the buffaloes came to water. A few rods further on, he started dramatically, and, alighting, proceeded to slowly examine the ground. It seemed to be scattered over with half-circular patches, which he pointed out mysteriously as buffalo chip. To Clarence's inexperienced perception, the plain bore a singular resemblance to the surface of an ordinary unromantic cattle pasture that somewhat chilled his heroic fancy. However, the two companions halted and professionally examined their arms and equipments. These, I grieve to say, though varied, were scarcely full or satisfactory. The necessities of their flight had restricted Jim to an old double-barreled fowling piece, which he usually carried slung across his shoulders, an old-fashioned six-shooter, whose barrels revolved occasionally and unexpectedly, known as Allen's Pepper Box on account of its culinary resemblance, and a bowie knife. Clarence carried an Indian bow and arrow with which he had been exercising, and a hatchet which he had concealed under the flanks of his saddle. To this Jim generously added the six-shooter, taking the hatchet in exchange, a transfer that at first delighted Clarence, until, seeing the warlike and picturesque effect of the hatchet in Jim's belt, he regretted the transfer. The gun, Jim meantime explained, extra charged, chuck up to the middle with slugs and revolver bullets, could only be fired by himself, and even then, he darkly added, not without danger. This poverty of equipment was, however, compensated by opposite statements from Jim of the extraordinary results obtained by these simple weapons from fellers I knew. How he himself had once brought down a bull by a bold shot with a revolver through its open bellowing mouth that pierced his innards, how a friend of his, an intimate in fact, now in jail at Louisville for killing a sheriff's deputy, had once found himself alone and dismounted with a simple clasp knife and a lariat among a herd of buffaloes, how, leaping calmly upon the shaggy shoulders of the biggest bull, he lashed himself with the lariat firmly to its horns, goading it onward with his clasp knife, and subsisting for days upon the flesh cut from its living body, until, abandoned by its fellows and exhausted by the loss of blood, it finally succumbed to its victor at the very outskirts of the camp to which he had artfully driven it. It must be confessed that this recital somewhat took away Clarence's breath, and he would have liked to ask a few questions. But they were alone on the prairie, and linked by a common transgression, the glorious sun was coming up victoriously, the pure, crisp air was intoxicating their nerves, in the bright forecast of youth everything was possible. The surface of the bottom land that they were crossing was here and there broken up by fissures and potholes, and some circumspection in their progress became necessary. In one of these halts, Clarence was struck by a dull, monotonous jarring that sounded like the heavy regular fall of water over a dam. Each time that they slackened their pace, the sound would become more audible, and was at last accompanied by that slight but unmistakable tremor of the earth that betrayed the vicinity of a waterfall. Hesitating over the phenomenon, which seemed to imply that their topography was wrong and that they had blundered from the track, they were presently startled by the fact that the sound was actually approaching them. With a sudden instinct, they both galloped towards the lagoon. As the timber opened before them, Jim uttered a long ecstatic shout. "Why, it's them!" At a first glance it seemed to Clarence as if the whole plain beyond was broken up and rolling in tumbling waves or furrows towards them. A second glance showed the tossing fronts of a vast herd of buffaloes, and here and there, darting in and out and among them, or emerging from the cloud of dust behind, wild figures and flashes of fire. With the idea of water still in his mind, it seemed as if some tumultuous tidal wave were sweeping unseen towards the lagoon, carrying everything before it. He turned with eager eyes, in speechless expectancy, to his companion. Alack! That redoubtable hero and mighty hunter was, to all appearances, equally speechless and astonished. It was true that he remained rooted to the saddle, a lank, still heroic figure, alternately grasping his hatchet and gun with a kind of spasmodic regularity. How long he would have continued this would never be known, for the next moment, with a deafening crash, the herd broke through the brush, and, swerving at the right of the lagoon, bore down directly upon them. All further doubt or hesitation on their part was stopped. The far-seeing, sagacious Mexican plug with a terrific snort wheeled and fled furiously with his rider. Moved, no doubt, by touching fidelity, Clarence's humbler team horse instantly followed. In a few moments those devoted animals struggled neck to neck in noble emulation. "What are we going off this way for?" gasped the simple Clarence. "Peyton and Gildersleeve are back there and they'll see us," gasped Jim in reply. It struck Clarence that the buffaloes were much nearer them than the hunting party, and that the trampling hoofs of a dozen bulls were close behind them, but with another gasp he shouted, "When are we going to hunt them?" "Hunt them," screamed Jim, with a hysterical outburst of truth, "why, they're hunting us, dash it." Indeed, there was no doubt that their frenzied horses were flying before the equally frenzied herd behind them. They gained a momentary advantage by riding into one of the fissures, and out again on the other side, while their pursuers were obliged to make a detour. But in a few minutes they were overtaken by that part of the herd who had taken the other and nearer side of the lagoon, and were now fairly in the midst of them. The ground shook with their trampling hoofs, their steaming breath, mingling with the stinging dust that filled the air, half-choked and blinded Clarence. He was dimly conscious that Jim had wildly thrown his hatchet at a cow buffalo pressing close upon his flanks. As they swept down into another gully he saw him raise his fateful gun with utter desperation. Clarence crouched low on his horse's outstretched neck. There was a blinding flash, a single stunning report of both barrels, Jim reeled in one way half out of the saddle, while the smoking gun seemed to leap in another over his head, and then rider and horse vanished in a choking cloud of dust and gunpowder. A moment after Clarence's horse stopped with a sudden check, and the boy felt himself hurled over its head into the gully, alighting on something that seemed to be a bounding cushion of curled and twisted hair. It was the shaggy shoulder of an enormous buffalo. For Jim's desperate random shot and double charge had taken effect on the near hind leg of a preceding bull, tearing away the flesh and hamstringing the animal, who had dropped in the gully just in front of Clarence's horse. Dazed but unhurt, the boy rolled from the lifted forequarters of the struggling brute to the ground. When he staggered to his feet again, not only his horse was gone but the whole herd of buffalo seemed to have passed too, and he could hear the shouts of unseen hunters now ahead of him. They had evidently overlooked his fall, and the gully had concealed him. The sides before him were too steep for his aching limbs to climb, the slope by which he and the bull had descended when the collision occurred was behind the wounded animal. Clarence was staggering towards it when the bull, by a supreme effort, lifted itself on three legs, half-turned, and faced him. These events had passed too quickly for the inexperienced boy to have felt any active fear, or indeed anything but wild excitement and confusion. But the spectacle of that shaggy and enormous front, that seemed to fill the whole gully, rising with awful deliberation between him and escape, sent a thrill of terror through his frame. The great, dull, bloodshot eyes glared at him with a dumb, wondering fury, the large wet nostrils were so near that their first snort of inarticulate rage made him reel backwards as from a blow. The gully was only a narrow and short fissure or subsidence of the plain, a few paces more of retreat and he would be at its end, against an almost perpendicular bank 15 feet high. If he attempted to climb its crumbling sides and fell, there would be those short but terrible horns waiting to impale him. It seemed too terrible, too cruel. He was so small beside this overgrown monster. It wasn't fair. The tears started to his eyes, and then, in a rage at the injustice of fate, he stood doggedly still with clenched fists. He fixed his gaze with half-hysterical, childish fury on those lurid eyes. He did not know that, owing to the strange magnifying power of the bull's convex pupils, he, Clarence, appeared much bigger than he really was to the brute's heavy consciousness, the distance from him most deceptive, and that it was to this fact that hunters so often owed their escape. He only thought of some desperate means of attack. Ah! The six-shooter. It was still in his pocket. He drew it nervously, hopelessly it looked so small compared with his large enemy. He presented it with flashing eyes, and pulled the trigger. A feeble click followed, another, and again. Even this had mocked him. He pulled the trigger once more, wildly, there was a sudden explosion, and another. He stepped back, the balls had apparently flattened themselves harmlessly on the bull's forehead. He pulled again, hopelessly, there was another report, a sudden furious bellow, and the enormous brute threw his head savagely to one side, burying his left horn deep in the crumbling bank beside him. Again and again he charged the bank, driving his left horn home, and bringing down the stones and earth in showers. It was some seconds before Clarence saw in a single glimpse of that wildly tossing crest the reason of this fury. The blood was pouring from his left eye, penetrated by the last bullet, the bull was blinded. A terrible revulsion of feeling, a sudden sense of remorse that was for the moment more awful than even his previous fear, overcame him. He had done that thing. As much to fly from the dreadful spectacle as any instinct of self-preservation, he took advantage of the next mad paroxysms of pain and blindness, that always impelled the suffering beast towards the left, to slip past him on the right, reach the incline, and scramble wildly up to the plain again. Here he ran confusedly forward, not knowing whither, only caring to escape that agonized bellowing, to shut out forever the accusing look of that huge blood-weltering eye. Suddenly he heard a distant angry shout. To his first hurried glance the plain had seemed empty, but, looking up, he saw two horsemen rapidly advancing with a led horse behind them his own. With the blessed sense of relief that overtook him now came the fevered desire for sympathy and to tell them all. But as they came nearer he saw that they were Gildersleeve, the scout, and Henry Benham, and that, far from sharing any delight in his deliverance, their faces only exhibited irascible impatience. Overcome by this new defeat, the boy stopped, again dumb and dogged. "Now, then, blank it all, will you get up and come along, or do you reckon to keep the train waiting another hour over your blank foolishness?" said Gildersleeve savagely. The boy hesitated, and then mounted mechanically, without a word. "'Twould have served em right to have gone and left em," muttered Benham vindictively. For one wild instant Clarence thought of throwing himself from his horse and bidding them go on and leave him. But before he could put his thought into action the two men were galloping forward, with his horse led by a lariat fastened to the horn of Gildersleeve's saddle. In 2 hours more they had overtaken the train, already on the march, and were in the midst of the group of outriders. Judge Peyton's face, albeit a trifle perplexed, turned towards Clarence with a kindly, half-tolerant look of welcome. The boy's heart instantly melted with forgiveness. "Well, my boy, let's hear your story. What happened?" Clarence cast a hurried glance around, and saw Jim, with face averted, riding gloomily behind. Then nervously and hurriedly he told how he had been thrown into the gully on the back of the wounded buffalo, and the manner of his escape. An audible titter ran through the cavalcade. Mr. Peyton regarded him gravely. "But how did the buffalo get so conveniently into the gully?" he asked. "Jim Hooker lamed him with a shotgun, and he fell over," said Clarence timidly. A roar of Homeric laughter went up from the party. Clarence looked up, stung and startled, but caught a single glimpse of Jim Hooker's face that made him forget his own mortification. In its hopeless, heartsick, and utterly beaten dejection, the first and only real expression he had seen on it, he read the dreadful truth. Jim's reputation had ruined him. The one genuine and striking episode of his life, the one trustworthy account he had given of it, had been unanimously accepted as the biggest and most consummate lie of his record. Chapter 7. With this incident of the hunt closed, to Clarence, the last remembered episode of his journey. But he did not know until long after that it had also closed to him what might have been the opening of a new career. for it had been Judge Peyton's intention in adopting Susie to include a certain guardianship and protection of the boy, provided he could get the consent of that vague relation to whom he was consigned. But it had been pointed out by Mrs. Peyton and her brother that Clarence's association with Jim Hooker had made him a doubtful companion for Susie, and even the judge himself was forced to admit that the boy's apparent taste for evil company was inconsistent with his alleged birth and breeding. Unfortunately, Clarence, in the conviction of being hopelessly misunderstood, and that dogged acquiescence to fate which was one of his characteristics, was too proud to correct the impression by any of the hypocrisies of childhood. He had also a cloudy instinct of loyalty to Jim in his disgrace, without, however, experiencing either the sympathy of an equal or the zeal of a partisan, but rather, if it could be said of a boy of his years, with the patronage and protection of a superior. So he accepted without demur the intimation that when the train reached California he would be forwarded from Stockton with an outfit and a letter of explanation to Sacramento, it being understood that in the event of not finding his relative he would return to the Peytons in one of the southern valleys, where they elected to purchase a tract of land. With this outlook, and the prospect of change, independence, and all the rich possibilities that to the imagination of youth are included in them, Clarence had found the days dragging. The halt at Salt Lake, the transit of the dreary alkali desert, even the wild passage of the Sierras, were but a blurred picture in his memory. The sight of eternal snows and the rolling of endless ranks of pines, the first glimpse of a hillside of wild oats, the spectacle of a rushing yellow river that to his fancy seemed tinged with gold, were momentary excitements, quickly forgotten. But when, one morning, halting at the outskirts of a struggling settlement, he found the entire party eagerly gathered around a passing stranger, who had taken from his saddlebags a small buckskin pouch to show them a double handful of shining scales of metal, Clarence felt the first feverish and overmastering thrill of the gold seekers. Breathlessly he followed the breathless questions and careless replies. The gold had been dug out of a placer only 30 miles away. It might be worth, say, $150. It was only his share of a week's work with two partners. It was not much, the country was getting played out with fresh arrivals and greenhorns. All this falling carelessly from the unshaven lips of a dusty, roughly dressed man, with a long-handled shovel and pickaxe strapped on his back, and a frying pan depending from his saddle. But no panoplied or armed knight ever seemed so heroic or independent a figure to Clarence. What could be finer than the noble scorn conveyed in his critical survey of the train, with its comfortable covered wagons and appliances of civilization? Yell HEV to get rid of them their fixins if you're going in for placer diggin'. What a corroboration of Clarence's real thoughts. What a picture of independence was this. The picturesque scout, the all-powerful Judge Peyton, the daring young officer, all crumbled on their clay pedestals before this hero in a red flannel shirt and high-topped boots. To stroll around in the open air all day, and pick up those shining bits of metal, without study, without method, or routine, this was really life, to someday come upon that large nugget you couldn't lift, that was worth as much as the train and horses, such a one as the stranger said was found the other day at Sawyer's Bar, this was worth giving up everything for. That rough man, with his smile of careless superiority, was the living link between Clarence and the Thousand and One Nights, in him were Aladdin and Sindbad incarnate. 2 days later they reached Stockton. Here Clarence, whose single suit of clothes had been reinforced by patching, odds and ends from Peyton's stores, and an extraordinary costume of army cloth, got up by the regimental tailor at Fort Ridge, was taken to be refitted at a general furnishing emporium. But alas! In the selection of the clothing for that adult locality, scant provision seemed to have been made for a boy of Clarence's years, and he was with difficulty fitted from an old condemned government stores with a boy's seaman suit and a brass-buttoned pea jacket. To this outfit Mr. Peyton added a small sum of money for his expenses, and a letter of explanation to his cousin. The stagecoach was to start at noon. It only remained for Clarence to take leave of the party. The final parting with Susie had been discounted on the 2 previous days with some tears, small frights, and clingings, and the expressed determination on the child's part to go with him, but in the excitement of the arrival at Stockton it was still further mitigated, and under the influence of a little present from Clarence his first disbursement of his small capital had at last taken the form and promise of merely temporary separation. Nevertheless, when the boy's scanty pack was deposited under the stagecoach seat, and he had been left alone, he ran rapidly back to the train for one moment more with Susie. Panting and a little frightened, he reached Mrs. Peyton's car. "Goodness! You're not gone yet," said Mrs. Peyton sharply. "Do you want to lose the stage?" An instant before, in his loneliness, he might have answered, "Yes." But under the cruel sting of Mrs. Peyton's evident annoyance at his reappearance he felt his legs suddenly tremble, and his voice left him. He did not dare to look at Susie. But her voice rose comfortably from the depths of the wagon where she was sitting. "The stage will be gone away, Clarence." She too. Shame at his foolish weakness sent the yearning blood that had settled round his heart flying back into his face. "I was looking for Jim, ma'am," he said at last, boldly. He saw a look of disgust pass over Mrs. Peyton's face, and felt a malicious satisfaction as he turned and ran back to the stage. But here, to his surprise, he actually found Jim, whom he really hadn't thought of, darkly watching the last strapping of luggage. With a manner calculated to convey the impression to the other passengers that he was parting from a brother criminal, probably on his way to a state prison, Jim shook hands gloomily with Clarence, and eyed the other passengers furtively between his mated locks. "If ye hear o' anything happenin', ye'll know what's up," he said, in a low, hoarse, but perfectly audible whisper. "Me and them's bound to part company afore long. Tell the fellows at Deadman's Gulch to look out for me at any time." Although Clarence was not going to Deadman's Gulch, knew nothing of it, and had a faint suspicion that Jim was equally ignorant, yet as one or two of the passengers glanced anxiously at the demure, gray-eyed boy who seemed booked for such a baleful destination, he really felt the half-delighted, half-frightened consciousness that he was starting in life under fascinating immoral pretenses. But the forward spring of the fine-spirited horses, the quickened motion, the glittering sunlight, and the thought that he really was leaving behind him all the shackles of dependence and custom, and plunging into a life of freedom, drove all else from his mind. He turned at last from this hopeful, blissful future, and began to examine his fellow passengers with boyish curiosity. Wedged in between two silent men on the front seat, one of whom seemed a farmer, and the other, by his black attire, a professional man, Clarence was finally attracted by a black-mantled, dark-haired, bonnetless woman on the back seat, whose attention seemed to be monopolized by the jocular gallantries of her companions and the two men before her in the middle seat. From her position he could see little more than her dark eyes, which occasionally seemed to meet his frank curiosity in an amused sort of way, but he was chiefly struck by the pretty foreign sound of her musical voice, which was unlike anything he had ever heard before, and alas for the inconstancy of youth much finer than Mrs. Peyton's. Presently his farmer companion, casting a patronizing glance on Clarence's pea jacket and brass buttons, said cheerily, "Just off a voyage, sonny." "No, sir," stammered Clarence, "I came across the plains." "Then I reckon that's the rig out for the crew of a prairie schooner, eh?" There was a laugh at this which perplexed Clarence. Observing it, the humorist kindly condescended to explain that prairie schooner was the current slang for an emigrant wagon. "I couldn't," explained Clarence, naively looking at the dark eyes on the back seat, "get any clothes at Stockton but these. I suppose the folks didn't think there'd ever be boys in California." The simplicity of this speech evidently impressed the others, for the two men in the middle seats turned at a whisper from the lady and regarded him curiously. Clarence blushed slightly and became silent. Presently the vehicle began to slacken its speed. They were ascending a hill. On either bank grew huge cottonwoods, from which occasionally depended a beautiful scarlet vine. "Ah, it's pretty," said the lady, nodding her black-veiled head towards it. "It is good in the hair." One of the men made an awkward attempt to clutch a spray from the window. A brilliant inspiration flashed upon Clarence. When the stage began the ascent of the next hill, following the example of an outside passenger, he jumped down to walk. At the top of the hill he rejoined the stage, flushed and panting, but carrying a small branch of the vine in his scratched hands. Handing it to the man on the middle seat, he said, with grave, boyish politeness, "Please for the lady." A slight smile passed over the face of Clarence's neighbors. The bonnetless woman nodded a pleasant acknowledgement, and coquettishly wound the vine in her glossy hair. The dark man at his side, who hadn't spoken yet, turned to Clarence dryly. "If you're goin' to keep up this gait, sonny, I reckon ye won't find much trouble gettin' a man's suit to fit you by the time you reach Sacramento." Clarence didn't quite understand him, but noticed that a singular gravity seemed to overtake the two jocular men on the middle seat, and the lady looked out of the window. He came to the conclusion that he had made a mistake about alluding to his clothes and his size. He must try and behave more manly. That opportunity seemed to be offered 2 hours later, when the stage stopped at a wayside hotel or restaurant. Two or three passengers had got down to refresh themselves at the bar. His right and left-hand neighbors were, however, engaged in a drawling conversation on the comparative merits of San Francisco sandhill and water lots. The jocular occupants of the middle seat were still engrossed with the lady. Clarence slipped out of the stage and entered the bar room with some ostentation. The complete ignoring of his person by the barkeeper and his customers, however, somewhat disconcerted him. He hesitated a moment, and then returned gravely to the stage door and opened it. "Would you mind taking a drink with me, sir?" said Clarence politely, addressing the farmer-looking passenger who had been most civil to him. A dead silence followed. The two men on the middle seat faced entirely around to gaze at him. "The Commodore asks if you'll take a drink with him," explained one of the men to Clarence's friend with the greatest seriousness. "Eh? Oh, yes, certainly," returned that gentleman, changing his astonished expression to one of the deepest gravity, "seeing it's the Commodore. And perhaps you and your friend will join, too," said Clarence timidly to the passenger who had explained, "and you too, sir," he added to the dark man. "Really, gentlemen, I don't see how we can refuse," said the latter, with the greatest formality, and appealing to the others. "A compliment of this kind from our distinguished friend is not to be taken lightly. I have observed, sir, that the Commodore's head is level," returned the other man with equal gravity. Clarence could have wished they had not treated his first hospitable effort quite so formally, but as they stepped from the coach with unbending faces he led them, a little frightened, into the bar room. Here, unfortunately, as he was barely able to reach over the counter, the barkeeper would have again overlooked him but for a quick glance from the dark man, which seemed to change even the barkeeper's perfunctory smiling face into supernatural gravity. "The Commodore is standing treat," said the dark man, with unbroken seriousness, indicating Clarence and leaning back with an air of respectful formality. "I will take straight whiskey. The Commodore, on account of just changing climate, will, I believe, for the present content himself with lemon soda." Clarence had previously resolved to take whiskey, like the others, but a little doubtful of the politeness of countermanding his guest's order, and perhaps slightly embarrassed by the fact that all the other customers seemed to have gathered round him and his party with equally immovable faces, he said hurriedly, "Lemon soda for me, please." "The Commodore," said the barkeeper with impassive features, as he bent forward and wiped the counter with professional deliberation, "is right. No matter how much a man may be accustomed all his life to liquor, when he is changing climate, gentlemen, he says lemon soda for me all the time." "Perhaps," said Clarence, brightening, "you will join too." "I shall be proud on this occasion, sir." "I think," said the tall man, still as ceremoniously unbending as before, "that there can be but one toast here, gentlemen. I give you the health of the Commodore. May his shadow never be less." The health was drunk solemnly. Clarence felt his cheeks tingle and in his excitement drank his own health with the others. Yet he was disappointed that there was not more joviality, he wondered if men always drank together so stiffly. And it occurred to him that it would be expensive. Nevertheless, he had his purse already ostentatiously in his hand. In fact, the paying for it out of his own money was not the least manly and independent pleasure he had promised himself. "How much?" he asked, with an affectation of carelessness. The barkeeper cast his eye professionally over the barroom. "I think you said treats for the crowd, call it $20 to make even change." Clarence's heart sank. He had heard already of the exaggeration of California prices. $20. It was half his fortune. Nevertheless, with an heroic effort, he controlled himself, and with slightly nervous fingers counted out the money. It struck him, however, as curious, not to say ungentlemanly, that the bystanders craned their necks over his shoulder to look at the contents of his purse, although some slight explanation was offered by the tall man. "The Commodore's purse, gentlemen, is really a singular one. Permit me," he said, taking it from Clarence's hand with great politeness. "It is one of the new pattern, you observe, quite worthy of inspection." He handed it to a man behind him, who in turn handed it to another, while a chorus of "something quite new, the latest style," followed it in its passage round the room, and indicated to Clarence its whereabouts. It was presently handed back to the barkeeper, who had begged also to inspect it, and who, with an air of scrupulous ceremony, insisted upon placing it himself in Clarence's side pocket, as if it were an important part of his function. The driver here called all aboard. The passengers hurriedly reseated themselves, and the episode abruptly ended. For, to Clarence's surprise, these attentive friends of a moment ago at once became interested in the views of a new passenger concerning the local politics of San Francisco, and he found himself utterly forgotten. The bonnetless woman had changed her position, and her head was no longer visible. The disillusion and depression that overcame him suddenly were as complete as his previous expectations and hopefulness had been extravagant. For the first time his utter unimportance in the world and his inadequacy to this new life around him came upon him crushingly. The heat and jolting of the stage caused him to fall into a slight slumber, and when he awoke he found his two neighbors had just got out at a wayside station. They had evidently not cared to waken him to say goodbye. From the conversation of the other passengers he learned that the tall man was a well-known gambler, and the one who looked like a farmer was a ship captain who had become a wealthy merchant. Clarence thought he understood now why the latter had asked him if he came off a voyage, and that the nickname of Commodore given to him, Clarence, was some joke intended for the captain's understanding. He missed them, for he wanted to talk to them about his relative at Sacramento, whom he was now so soon to see. At last, between sleeping and waking, the end of his journey was unexpectedly reached. It was dark, but, being steamer night, the shops and business places were still open, and Mr. Payton had arranged that the stage driver should deliver Clarence at the address of his relative in J Street, an address which Clarence had luckily remembered. But the boy was somewhat discomfited to find that it was a large office or banking house. He, however, descended from the stage, and with his small pack in his hand entered the building as the stage drove off, and, addressing one of the busy clerks, asked for Mr. Jackson Brandt. There was no such person in the office. There never had been any such person. The bank had always occupied that building. Was there not some mistake in the number? No, the name, number, and street had been deeply engrafted in the boy's recollection. Stop. It might be the name of a customer who had given his address at the bank. The clerk who made the suggestion disappeared promptly to make inquiries in the counting room. Clarence, with a rapidly beating heart, awaited him. The clerk returned. There was no such name on the books. Jackson Brandt was utterly unknown to everyone in the establishment. For an instant the counter against which the boy was leaning seemed to yield with his weight. He was obliged to steady himself with both hands to keep from falling. It was not his disappointment, which was terrible, it was not a thought of his future, which seemed hopeless, it was not his injured pride at appearing to have willfully deceived Mr. Peyton, which was more dreadful than all else, but it was the sudden, sickening sense that he himself had been deceived, tricked, and fooled. For it flashed upon him for the first time that the vague sense of wrong which had always haunted him was this, that this was the vile culmination of a plan to get rid of him, and that he had been deliberately lost and led astray by his relatives as helplessly and completely as a useless cat or dog. Perhaps there was something of this in his face, for the clerk, staring at him, bade him sit down for a moment, and again vanished into the mysterious interior. Clarence had no conception how long he was absent, or indeed anything but his own breathless thoughts, for he was conscious of wondering afterwards why the clerk was leading him through a door in the counter into an inner room of many desks, and again through a glass door into a smaller office, where a preternaturally busy-looking man sat writing at a desk. Without looking up, but pausing only to apply a blotting pad to the paper before him, the man said crisply, "So you've been consigned to someone who don't seem to turn up, and can't be found, eh? Never mind that," as Clarence laid Peyton's letter before him. "Can't read it now. Well, I suppose you want to be shipped back to Stockton." "No," said the boy, recovering his voice with an effort. "Eh, that's business, though. Know anybody here?" "Not a living soul, that's why they sent me," said the boy, in sudden reckless desperation. He was the more furious that he knew the tears were standing in his eyes. The idea seemed to strike the man amusingly. "Looks a little like it, don't it?" he said, smiling grimly at the paper before him. "Got any money?" "A little." "How much?" "About $20, said Clarence hesitatingly. The man opened a drawer at his side, mechanically, for he did not raise his eyes, and took out two $10 gold pieces. "I'll go 20 better," he said, laying them down on the desk. "That'll give you a chance to look around. Come back here, if you don't see your way clear." He dipped his pen into the ink with a significant gesture as if closing the interview. Clarence pushed back the coin. "I'm not a beggar," he said doggedly. The man this time raised his head and surveyed the boy with two keen eyes. "You're not, hey? Well, do I look like one?" "No," stammered Clarence, as he glanced into the man's haughty eyes. "Yet, if I were in your fix, I'd take that money and be glad to get it." "If you'll let me pay you back again," said Clarence, a little ashamed, and considerably frightened at his implied accusation of the man before him. "You can," said the man, bending over his desk again. Clarence took up the money and awkwardly drew out his purse. But it was the first time he had touched it since it was returned to him in the bar room, and it struck him that it was heavy and full indeed, so full that on opening it a few coins rolled out onto the floor. The man looked up abruptly. "I thought you said you had only $20, he remarked grimly. "Mr. Peyton gave me 40, returned Clarence, stupefied and blushing. "I spent $20 for drinks at the bar and," he stammered, I don't know how the rest came here." "You spent $20 for drinks," said the man, laying down his pen, and leaning back in his chair to gaze at the boy. "Yes, that is, I treated some gentlemen of the stage, sir, at Davidson's Crossing."
"Did you treat the whole stage company?"
"No, sir, only about four or five and the barkeeper. But everything's so dear in California."
"I know that."
"Evidently.
But it don't seem to make much difference with you," said the man, glancing at the purse.
"They wanted my purse to look at," said Clarence hurriedly, "and that's how the thing happened. Somebody put his own money back into my purse by accident."
"Of course," said the man grimly.
"Yes, that's the reason," said Clarence, a little relieved, but somewhat embarrassed by the man's persistent eyes.
"Then, of course," said the other quietly, "you don't require my $20 now."
"But," returned Clarence hesitatingly, "this isn't my money. I must find out who it belongs to, and give it back again.
Perhaps," he added timidly, "I might leave it here with you, and call for it when I find the man, or send him here. With the greatest gravity he here separated the surplus from what was left of Peyton's gift and the $20 he had just received. The balance unaccounted for was $40. He laid it on the desk before the man, who, still looking at him, rose and opened the door. Mr. Reed. The clerk who had shown Clarence in appeared. Open an account with he stopped and turned interrogatively to Clarence. Clarence Brandt, said Clarence, coloring with excitement. With Clarence Brandt. Take that deposit, pointing to the money, and give him a receipt. He paused as the clerk retired with a wondering gaze at the money, looked again at Clarence, said, I think you'll do, and re-entered the private office, closing the door behind him. I hope it will not be deemed inconceivable that Clarence, only a few moments before crushed with bitter disappointment and the hopeless revelation of his abandonment by his relatives, now felt himself lifted up suddenly into an imaginary height of independence and manhood. He was leaving the bank, in which he stood a minute before a friendless boy, not as a successful beggar, for this important man had disclaimed the idea, but absolutely as a customer. A depositor. A businessman like the grown-up clients who were thronging the outer office, and before the eyes of the clerk who had pitied him. And he, Clarence, had been spoken to by this man, whose name he now recognized as the one that was on the door of the building, a man of whom his fellow passengers had spoken with admiring envy, a banker famous in all California. Will it be deemed incredible that this imaginative and hopeful boy, forgetting all else, the object of his visit, and even the fact that he considered this money was not his own, actually put his hat a little on one side as he strolled out on his way to the streets and prospective fortune? 2 hours later the banker had another visitor. It chanced to be the farmer-looking man who had been Clarence's fellow passenger. Evidently a privileged person, he was at once ushered as Captain Stevens into the presence of the banker. At the end of a familiar business interview the captain asked carelessly, "Any letters for me?" The busy banker pointed with his pen to the letter S in a row of alphabetically labeled pigeonholes against the wall. The captain, having selected his correspondence, paused with a letter in his hand. "Look here, Carden, there are letters here for some chap called John Silsby. They were here when I called, 10 weeks ago." "Well, that's the name of that Pike County man who was killed by Injuns in the plains. The Frisco papers had all the particulars last night, maybe it's for that fellow. It hasn't got a postmark. Who left it here?" Mr. Carden summoned a clerk. It appeared that the letter had been left by a certain Brandt Fauquier, to be called for. Captain Stevens smiled. Brandt's been too busy dealin' faro to think of M.A.G.I.N., and since that shootin' affair at Angels I hear he's skipped to the southern coast somewhere. Cal Johnson, his old chum, was in the upstage from Stockton this afternoon. "Did you come by the upstage from Stockton this afternoon?" said Carden, looking up. "Yes, as far as 10 Mile Station Road the rest of the way here." "Did you notice a queer little old-fashioned kid about so high like a runaway schoolboy?"
"Did I?
By GD, sir, he treated me to drinks." Carden jumped from his chair. "Then he wasn't lying?"
"No.
We let him do it, but we made it good for the little chap afterwards.
Hello.
What's up?" But Mr. Carden was already in the outer office beside the clerk who had admitted Clarence. "You remember that boy Brandt who was here?"
"Yes, sir."
"Where did he go?"
"Don't know, sir."
"Go and find him somewhere and somehow. Go to all the hotels, restaurants, and gin mills near here, and hunt him up. Take someone with you, if you can't do it alone. Bring him back here, quick."
It was nearly midnight when the clerk fruitlessly returned. It was the fierce high noon of steamer nights, light flashed brilliantly from shops, counting houses, drinking saloons, and gambling hells. The streets were yet full of eager, hurrying feet swift of fortune, ambition, pleasure, or crime. But from among these deeper, harsher footfalls the echo of the homeless boy's light, innocent tread seemed to have died out forever.